Good morning, Summit. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and thank you for your patience. Just a little spoiler alert, it does have to do with a surprise that'll happen mid-service, so thank you for holding on. And now let's stand together and let's just engage in a time of worship. So God, we ask that you would come and meet us in this cold weather as we gather indoors together, and you would just pour out your presence, your joy, your peace, your comfort on us this morning as we sing your praises, as we declare who you are and what you're doing, and as we just receive the gift of the Savior and of your love and of the joy that you offer us. So God, we just dedicate this morning to you. May it be glorifying to you, and may you use it just to minister to our hearts this morning, God. We're just grateful to be together. Amen. So a call to worship from Isaiah 25:1. Praise to the Lord. Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. So this morning, let us join with the angels, with the heavens, as they declare that Christ has come. Let's sing together.
Angels from the realms of glory, bring your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Oh.
Sing shepherds in the field.
Shepherds in the fields abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with men is now residing, yonder shines the infant light. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Oh, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, you are the God.
Oh, come, Emmanuel,
till the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here, and drive away the shadows of night, and pierce the clouds and bring us light. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall
to the screen for an Advent video.
Different.
That's because it's the candle of joy.
What makes it special?
This is the Sunday we call a day. It is when we remember the baby in Elizabeth, John the Baptist, moved with joy upon his mother being greeted by Mary.
Rejoice in the Lord always. John the Baptist is in a lot of these Advent stories.
It's true. John the Baptist reminds us that Jesus is the
true light. I don't know what happened. Can anyone hear me?
What a great reminder of the joy that we experience with Jesus' birth. And it's also a joy that we are halfway through Advent to Christmas.
For some people, that might not be as joyful as it is for others. Instead of fretting about all we still haven't done to prepare for Christmas, we should think of all the good things that God and life has given us.
Let us pray. Holy and joyful God, we are surrounded by the gifts of laughter and high spirits. For this we are thankful. Help us to be spreaders of joy in the world. And when it is difficult to join in and see joy in every day, help us to remember that even when life is not good, God always is. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So we remember this joy that we have in Christ, and we continue to sing and to worship this morning. We haven't sang this chorus in a while, but I think you'll remember it. It goes like this.
Give me joy.
We're just so grateful. We're bursting with joy just at what you have done and what you continue to do. Lord, you are so good and you are so kind and you're so faithful. And we pray that just as we continue to sit in your presence today, joy the fellowship we have here as we hear your word preached. God, just move in us. God, may this joy just come to the surface and send us out as beacons of your light and your hope and your joy into this world. God, we are yours. We open ourselves to you, knowing that you are so good. So be with us this morning, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Our special visitor on the screen. How good is it to see our sweet Marla in the flesh?
So nice to see you guys.
Yay, we can hear you. So good.
It's day four, so I'm not looking super hot.
Oh, it is just really good to see you. So Marla, let's quickly, because I know she is getting tired, so we're going to make this quick, but we are thankful you are here. These last couple months have been so tough for you and your family, and things about 2.5 weeks ago got extra scary. So can you just kind of quickly go over how that all was going pre-surgery?
Yep, I think everyone knows all the details. Is just super dicey. I hope you guys can hear me. I have a roommate, so I need to be quiet. Yeah, it was just every complication that could have happened, it seemed. And just everyone knows it was a really long wait.
It was, but we definitely saw God's hand, and I think you felt God's hand in it while you were waiting. And all of us here have been praying and praying for a miracle. And I spoke with Marla Tuesday night, and I had Emery in the car with me. And Marla that night said, "Kristen, I don't know if I can talk long. I'm not sure how I'm doing." And then we quickly finished the conversation with Marla saying, "Okay, we're going to pray for a liver, pray for a liver, pray for a liver." And so we did that, and I prayed as much as I could that night. And when I woke up at 4 a.m. with Rhett, I saw Marla's text that a liver had become available. And as soon as I woke up, I told Emery, and Emery looked at me, and she was like, "Mom, the last thing Marla said was to pray for a liver, pray for a liver. And Mom, it worked." So how, when that happened and you got that news, how did that feel?
Yeah. Again, anyone who knows, I'm super, super emotional. I don't have any more tears left because it's just all been truly there aren't words.
Absolutely.
There just literally aren't words.
I get that. So. Okay. Lastly, I'm going to give you time to talk, and while you say what you need to say, I want you to tell us how we as a community can continue to pray for you and support you.
Do you think there's anything else left possible that Summit could do?
Well,
I don't.
We can still
pray. I really don't. I really, really don't like it. I've been everything. For my kids, for everything, God, family, everything.
Well, we all love you so much. We all love your girls.
I do too. I can't wait to see you guys and hug you.
Yes, I was thinking that. I can't wait to give you a big hug. And your girls are here this morning, so this was perfect. They get to see Mom. So
thank you. Love you guys.
Okay, thank you. Take care of yourself. I hope you have a really good sleep. Guys, we need to pray for Marla to sleep. The poor thing was awake all night. So we pray for rest, and we just know that the days are going to get better and better, and we are so thankful for you.
Amen. We'll be watching. Love you guys.
Well, good morning, Summit. Do you ever cry tears of joy? I don't very often, but I did. I am. When we got the news of Marla's liver transplant coming in, Cheryl came in and she was crying and shaking, and she's like, "You got to hear this news," and it's such an answer to prayer. So thank you to everybody for all of your prayers, and I feel like this has been a season where we've come together as a community in prayer, which is powerful. And so it's moving. God's power is amazing. God's timing is not what I would pick. And that's a question I've got for him when we get there. But his timing is perfect as well. And it's faith stretching. And sorry. Okay, so good morning and welcome to Summit, where we exist to guide all people into a lifelong, authentic relationship with Jesus. And we do that together, practicing the way of Jesus. We've got a few announcements for you this morning. My name is Mike, in case I forgot to say that. A couple of announcements. So next Sunday is our annual Christmas brunch. So it's a potluck brunch. Please bring a breakfast dish to share and tune up your singing voice. We're going to sing some carols. We're going to have some fun. We're going to have some food together. And remember, Pastor Drew is looking for bacon, lots of bacon. So if you're wondering what to make, make some bacon. So that's the 19th. Then on the 24th, Christmas Eve, which is Friday, service is at 4 o'clock. Thanks to everybody that responded to the text this week so we can get a sense of numbers. I think we're good there. Please do arrive just before 4 so we can get everybody set up. We'll have the kids with some activities downstairs and then the service here in the gym. And then on the 2nd, there is no in-person service. So once a year, we take that one Sunday off, and so that's the Sunday off, but there is an online service that you can access. So you can still gather with family and friends. You can watch the online service. It's a recorded service, I believe, on the 2nd, and then we're back in person on the 9th. Also, just want to remind everybody that here at Summit, we don't pass a collection plate, but there is an offering box at the back for you to participate as God leads you to participate in the ministry of Summit. And there's also lots of online options for you to participate in as well. As we approach year end, it's the end of the tax receipt season at the end of December. So unlike your RSP contributions, which you can make, you know, into the new year and apply them to the last year, you can't do that with giving, right? So if you've got some giving that's on your heart that you want to do, you want to get that done before the end of December. And thank you for your support of the mission and the ministry here at Summit Church. And I think that's all the announcements. So I'm going to invite Larry to come forward. So Larry's going to bring the word for us today. Oh, and I'm going to invite the kids to join Miss Kristen and Dale and Susan at the back. And the kids are dismissed for downstairs. And we will bring them back. January 3rd. There's no service on January 3rd. Did I say January 2nd? I did say that. Okay, whatever the Sunday is, the first Sunday after Christmas, it's the 3rd. Don't come on the 3rd. There's no service. There's also no service on the 2nd because that's not Sunday. So, yeah, there's no service on the Sunday. Sunday is the 2nd. Okay, on the 2nd, no service online. There is a service. This is what I said at the beginning, but then I got mixed up, so I'm just reiterating. The 2nd, no service, nothing in person, but you can join online on the 2nd. On the 9th, please come back. Or if you're online, we'll be live streaming again on the 9th, and you can look forward to that. All right, Larry, every time I introduce you, something happens. I think last time it was like my phone was ringing, and I was standing here with Drew, and he was phoning me, and he had pocket dialed me. And so today, I'm getting the dates mixed up, but there you go. That's the kind of family that we are. So thank you for joining us again this morning. Larry's going to bring the word as we continue on in our series of Songs of the Saviour. And so if I can just pray for you, and then I'll turn it over to you, and things will get more professional after that. Heavenly Father, thanks for this morning, Lord. Thanks for the celebration that it is to be in your presence, to witness your miracles, to witness your power, Lord, and we just give you all the glory. And I pray, Lord, that you would speak powerfully to us this morning through Larry and his words, give him the confidence, give him the words to convey that message so clearly to us, that we would understand your love even deeper and your call on our lives even better. We commit this time to you and commit Larry to you. Thank you for the blessing that he is in our lives and to our church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mike. Hey, you did great, by the way. I could write a book on all the things I've done that are far, far more worse than that. So you're doing absolutely great. And I'm so glad to be here this morning. I thank God for the opportunity to continue to walk through this this series of sermons during this awesome season. And I just, man, that really moved my heart. I just think that is so amazing. I want to just, another book that I think Marby and I could write would be on ways that God just showed up and answered prayer in super tangible ways that just left us blown away. But my favorite part was the effect it had on our daughters, because some of the most significant moments of seeing God answer prayer, like in just this totally wow, blown away, mind-blowing way, was when they prayed. And I think of Hurricane Mitch many years ago. You can Google that. In fact, I encourage you to Google Hurricane Mitch. We were working as missionaries in Belize, Central America. And look at the images, the map images of the trajectory of that Category 5 hurricane that would have wiped us off the map totally. And look at what it does to the country of Belize, and you'll see that never happens. Meteorologists were totally stunned, and I give all the credit to our little, was five years old. She's about 5 years old. We had just talked about Jesus calming the storm. And it was a few hours away. We were already holed up with sandbags and extra provisions, and we thought the worst was going to happen. And all she said before going to sleep was, "Jesus, can you please do that for this storm that's coming?" And within a few hours, it did what it did, which was just mind-blowing. So check it out. You'll see what happened there. Anyway, that's just a little example of how it's important to let our kids see how prayer works, man. Let them see. Guide our kids through the power of prayer. Let them experience prayer like that. I just love stories like that where there's an answer and we just say, "Oh my, wow, that's incredible." Because that's what, I think God loves to do that. And what an affirmation. We still talk about those moments with our girls. And when life gets tough, when life gets really tough and it doesn't make sense now as adults, we often say, "Remember that time? Wasn't that amazing?" And it's like, okay. And then we pray. It's awesome. It's awesome. I also love everything about this season of the year. I just love this time of year. I love Christmas. I love the songs. We don't sing them too much other times of the year, but we sure love singing them this time. I love the music. I love the food. Oh, I love the food. I love the decorations. What else? I love the food. I love the family time together. I love the food. I love the presents, you know, opening gifts, and I love the food. But I love the way the story unfolds in the Gospels. That's my favorite thing. It's just to come back. If we haven't read that during the rest of the year, we take time, we read. And my family tradition growing up, and we did this with our girls, was that every Christmas Eve, I read the account in the book of Luke of Jesus' birth and all of that. And we'd read that. And it was always, you know, our girls would be squirming just like I was as a little kid, because after that, we opened the presents on Christmas Eve. So it was like, hurry up, read the story. Uh-huh, yeah, he's born. Yeah, the angels, yeah. Okay, let's get to the presents, you know. But it was, I love now just being able to let that just soak in, you know, the story of the Gospels and the narrative, the history. And we've already heard about Zechariah's song. So we're going through a series of songs that appear in the Gospels where people, just because of this event, they just sang this song of praise. So there's Zechariah's song. We've heard a Mary's song by Elisha last week, and fantastic message on Mary's song. There's the song of the choir of angels. There's, you know, there's just these amazing songs. They were sung in honor of this amazing person, Jesus, who was born. God became flesh. God took on humanity. Jesus, God the Son, took on humanity. And today we're looking at another song that was sung in honor of Jesus, but it was somebody that didn't have anything to do with, like, the events around Jesus being born. He's not a parent. He wasn't on the scene when Jesus was born. He wasn't, you know, out in the fields and the angels, and then they came and they, you know, he wasn't one of those people that were directly involved. And even Zechariah was, you know, Elizabeth and related, John the Baptist, all of that stuff. This is a totally different person, but it's somebody who is important because he did honor and recognize who Jesus was. He recognized him, and he couldn't help but just declare it out loud. His name is Simeon, and his short appearance is recorded in Luke chapter 2. And I just want to just give a little bit of background from the chapter to understand a little bit the setting that sets a stage for his heartfelt song of praise. We need to look at a couple of key things, but before that, I just want to just give this time to God. God, thank you for the privilege of looking at this moment in history, the first person to openly declare and identify Jesus, the first human being to openly understand and declare. And it's recorded for us to be reminded of how important this is and how we can apply it into our lives. God, I just ask that you take this time, bless this next few minutes. Lord, I just pray that we would just soak this up, take it from your word. It's just practical. There's nothing really super profound here. It's just something very real, exciting, and something that means everything to those of us who believe in Jesus. So thank you, God. Take this time. It's your time, not my time. It's your time. Use it for your glory and in each of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so the first thing I want to look at is, where were they and why were they even there? So in verses 21 to 24 of chapter 2, we read this in the New Living Translation. 8 days later, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel even before he was conceived. All this was part of the plan. All this was part of God's plan. He already had a name. It was announced, and it was already chosen. And the name was applied to the male child at the time of circumcision. And so this was where he was officially named Jesus. And then it says in verse 22, then it was time for their purification offering, as required by the law of Moses after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Center of worship. The law of the Lord says, if a woman's first child is a boy, he must be dedicated to the Lord. So they offered the sacrifice required in the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So that's where they are. They've come to Jerusalem to do this. And then in comes this person into the whole scene, into their lives for just a few minutes, and leaves them kind of, whoa, amazed. But who is this Simeon, and what does he have to do with anything? Well, let's read on in verse 25 to 28. It says this. At that time, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was righteous and devout and was eagerly waiting for the Messiah to come and rescue Israel. Why? Why was he? Everybody was waiting, but what was special about Simeon? The Holy Spirit was upon him, it says, and had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Hundreds of years they were waiting for someone to come and rescue them, especially under the empirical oppression of the Romans. And this guy hears from the Holy Spirit, you're not going to die until you've seen him. Can you imagine how that would feel? To just every day be like, well, where is he? You know, is it that guy? Is it that guy?
And it goes beyond that even. It says that that day the Spirit led him to the temple. So when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord as the law required, Simeon was there. And he recognized him, because out of all those people, out of the many babies that might have been there today, that day, I don't know how many there were, but he took that child, he took Jesus in his arms. He just knew. And he starts to praise God. We'll get to that. But let's pull the information right out of the story. So who is he? Well, he was a man from Jerusalem. Two, he was righteous and devout. In other words, you know, in all the hustle and bustle of life, he was one of those rare people who just, he was seeking God and he was devoted to God in the midst of everything that was going on in society, all the different philosophies and ways of thought and ideologies and religiousness and everything. He just was a man who was devout and righteous, and he was living his life according to God's ideals and plans, and he was blessed because of it, but he was devoted to God. And because of that, he was listening when the Holy Spirit told him some things. And so he was waiting for the spiritual and physical rescue of his people. It was promised. It was promised from earlier, but he had something special. The Holy Spirit was upon him and had revealed to him that he wasn't going to die until he saw the Redeemer, the Savior. Wow. And then the Holy Spirit moves him, and he goes into the area of the temple. He didn't just come to the temple that day. He was like in the area where, as they walked in, it was just like it was a no-brainer for him. The Holy Spirit was guiding this whole thing, and when he saw Jesus, he knew. So the question is, who's really behind this amazing moment in the lives of Jesus, in the life of Mary, in the life of Joseph, the life of Simeon? Who's behind all this? Well, he's mentioned several times here. The Holy Spirit is there, and he's working. In fact, he's been there for a while. He's been orchestrating this moment for a reason. And God, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Godhead, the three in one, an equal member of the Trinity, he's just working. It's exciting to see what he's doing here. But why is this significant? Because I think perhaps because this is the first open and audible declaration by a human being that this human baby is in fact the Messiah that everyone's been waiting for. This is the one that was promised, and that Simeon was told by the Holy Spirit he wouldn't die until he saw. This is him. This is him. And he's the first human being, and not just to the Jews, but he's here for everybody. And he declares this in his song. And the angels had declared, you know, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill to man. Go and you will find the Savior. You know, and they announced it. So it was angelically announced. Later on, John the Baptist would point right at Jesus and say, hey, you see that guy? That's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. That's him. That's much later. That's years later. But this is Simeon. He's just a normal guy. He's a normal guy. And the Holy Spirit is saying, say it. Just, you know who he is. You know what this means. Now it's been fulfilled. And it's just awesome. And so in Simeon's journey of life, it was the recognition of who is this baby? Who is it? And he says something in his song of praise that just opens it right up to what it really means. And he's holding this baby in his arms. I can't imagine what he's feeling, how his heart is just welling up inside of him. He's looking at this little baby. I don't know, maybe he was even crying at the moment. Mary's kind of like, would you mind, might be the diaper, I don't know. Just, do you really need to hold him right now? But here he is. And he breaks into this heartfelt song, and it just starts to flow from his heart and from his lips. And he says this: Sovereign Lord. Remember a few weeks ago we talked about sovereignty and what that means? You know, maybe that's already, it's gone. It could be. Usually sermons don't stick as much as we'd like them to, but there was one there somewhere. But you know what sovereign means. Or if not, look it up. It's a really cool word. We won't get into that right now, but he says, Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace as you have promised. Ah, now I can go to eternity with you with this peace in my heart that the Savior is here. My people will be rescued and the world will be rescued. He says, I have seen your salvation. I'm looking at your salvation, this little baby. I'm holding in my arms, which you have prepared, he says, for all people, all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people, Israel. Wow, he got it. And not to seem a little bit morbid here, but Simeon is clearly saying, I've waited so long for this, and I believed the promise that I would not die until I saw the Savior. I didn't quite imagine him this way. It's not what I had in mind. But now I can go to my eternal rest and life with the peace in my heart that the solution to all of mankind's problems, all the suffering, all the confusion, all of that, the solution is right here. I don't know what it's going to look like in the future. I won't be around to see how it unfolds. I just know that now I can go to eternity with peace in my heart, knowing that salvation is here. I don't know if it has anything to do with freeing my people from the empire that is so oppressive and that we're suffering under. But no matter what, this is the Messiah. This is our salvation, however that looks. And it's a light. A light. Man, that's a key word here. And I just want to pull that one right out of there. That just jumps out at me, like, of all the things he says, you know, that's the key. This is a light. This is a light. The Apostle John, in his book, the Gospel of John, he puts it so beautifully. Right from the very beginning, the Apostle John, who walked with Jesus and was with Jesus through his whole life and ministry, was right there to the very end. Saw him on the cross. Witnessed the resurrected Christ. He writes this, in the beginning, the Word already existed. And Word means Jesus in this context. Christ, the eternal Word. The Logos, the truth. In the beginning, the Word already existed, talking about Jesus. The Word was with God. The Word was God. So long before he became human in form as a little baby, the most humble, the most tangible, real form he could take on. Unexpected way for the Messiah to enter the world, but he was God. He existed in the beginning with God. He created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. John got it too. But here, long before anyone saw the ministry, the miracles, the death, the resurrection, any of that stuff, here's Simeon looking at this little baby saying, "This is the light. The light is right here." And John ends in verse 5 of chapter 1 this way. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Ah, all right. So I know everybody already knows these things, but they're just so cool. I gotta say it. Four things I love about light. Okay, let's think about light for a minute. Okay, I know we know this. This isn't like some kind of hoo-hoo revelation thing. I mean, but one thing I love about light is that it always gets rid of darkness, but it's never the other way around. Light always gets rid of darkness. You light that candle, you take it into a dark room, wherever it goes, the darkness is gone. But if you leave it alone in that room, and you walk out, and there's no air movement, I know we can blow out a candle, I know it gets, I'm talking about the darkness itself. If it were an entity, could it somehow, and the light goes out? Impossible. Light always gets rid of darkness, but the darkness can never put it out. And John said that. The darkness can never extinguish it. Two, light has the same impact and effect everywhere it goes. And that impact simply allows us to see, right? what is really there around us in all of its form and color. We know that. I know. I'm just reiterating what we already know, just for emphasis. But I love that about light, because it has that same impact everywhere. Now, it varies in degree of brightness and scope. You know, we've got this little candle, and we've got a million, 10 million candle plus spotlights that go, that we used to use actually for when the sun went down after we were fishing. We used to pull out the spotlight and we'd look for crocodiles on the river in Central America. If you've never done that, it's so much fun. Anyway, that's, now I'm getting way off track. But light, the light has that effect and impact. Now, it also allows the ability to see, which provides us with wise direction, okay? Again, we know that. But a light allows us to know, where am I going to put my foot next? Where should it land? What's the best spot for it to go? Should I go that way or that way? Well, a light will help in wise direction. And it allows the ability to provide security. The ability to see provides a certain security, okay? I mean, okay, I become aware because of light. Now, it's true, if I see the grizzly bear coming towards me, I'm feeling a bit of anxiety. But the truth is, I'd rather see him than only hear him. I'd rather see him, because then at least I know what's going on when I hear that noise that he makes, right? And which way to go away from him. So Simeon's response here is right on. And millions and millions, he's the first of millions of people who have understood this and declared it in very similar ways from that point in history on. So we have Peter's words in 1 Peter 2, verses, the second half of verse 8 and 9. He's now directing it towards us and saying, yes, we got this, but what about us? So he says this in verse 8, the second half, he says, they, and he's referring to those people who reject God's free gift of life and forgiveness in Jesus Christ. He's, because in the context, he was like, you know, there are people who don't want the light. But he says, they stumble because they do not obey God's word, and so they meet the fate that was planned for them. They accept that. They choose that by not receiving Jesus Christ. But you, speaking to us, believers in Jesus, those who are in Christ, he says, but you are not like that. You are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. Did you earn it? No. It was a free gift. It was a free gift. It was given to you. You received it. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. You are in the light. You have been made righteous because the righteousness of Jesus, this little baby that Simeon was holding in his hands, who later went to the ultimate price of the cross, gave his life, shed his blood in your place and my place, and rose again to be victorious over sin and death, to live in us and give us hope and bring that light into our lives. It's been placed on us. It's a righteousness that's been given to us when we receive it, and a gift is only ours when we receive it, and it's only a gift if we don't have to pay for it. So we say, Jesus, take over my life. Please forgive my sins, and please show me how I can live in your peace, in your joy, in your wisdom from this day forward. That's when we are ushered into the light from the darkness. And the best part is that Simeon totally understood this. And Peter says, well, you can show people this. And so I invite you to paint a scene in your mind right now. Just paint this scene in your mind. You're lost in a forest. It's pitch black. It's so dark, you cannot see a thing. I'm not trying to scare or freak anybody out here, so if it's wigging you out a little bit, just don't. That's okay. I don't want people to come out, that was the scariest sermon I ever. I don't want to go back there. Anyway, okay. You're out there in the forest. You can't see anything. But you're walking around. You're trying to find your way around, and you're getting hurt because the branches are, I mean, things are, you know, and you've stumbled. You've fallen a few times. You can't see anything. You're cold. You're lost. You can't see anything. You're hungry because you've been lost for a while. And you can't see anything. You're thirsty. You can't see anything. And you're hearing strange sounds that strike fear into the core of your being. you can't see anything, then it happens. You see a beam of light coming towards you in a distance. It's coming closer. And you realize that's a person. And they have a light with them. They have a flashlight. And what's happening in your heart and your mind right now as you see that person begin to approach you and come straight for you? And as they come closer, you hear their voice. Not a panicky voice, a very calm voice say, "It's okay. I'm here. I found you. It's okay. Now how do you feel? Now what's going through your heart and mind?" And then they reach into their backpack. They pull out a blanket and put it around your shoulders. They reach back into the backpack and they pull out a protein bar and hand it to you, already opened up, and you're so hungry, you just devour it in one gulp. And they pull into they go into their backpack another time and they pull out this beautiful bottle of water that's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen, and they take the top off for you and hand it to you, and you just chug that all down and you just start to feel totally different. And the best of all, they say, I got an extra flashlight. You want it? Would you like this flashlight? It's yours. I will give it to you. And you know what? I'd be happy to accompany you. You're actually just a few meters away from a cabin with a warm fire and a hot meal and safety. It's right there. I'll go with you. Would you like to? Do you remember when that happened in your life spiritually? Can you remember that time in your life when that happened for you? When you met Jesus? You met Jesus. Have you ever been the person who approaches somebody with the backpack and the flashlights? Has that ever been you? Now, I know that some of us have had the experience more than once, maybe, that we're the person with the backpack and the flashlight and we're offering the same things. And someone is in that darkness, and we want to share with them. We even tell them how we got from darkness to light, and we share all those things with them. And at the end of it all, they just say, "No, thank you." And to our shock, they walk back into the dark with nothing, and they prefer that, and it breaks our heart. Well, did we fail? Did the light go out? No. What do? We keep shining. We keep sharing. We keep praying. We keep looking for people like that, and we keep offering the same thing. We keep the backpack full. We keep the flashlight charged up, so to speak. But like Simeon, there's no better way to be ready for what lies beyond this life. There's no better way. I mean, we know that we're all going to this earthly life is not going to last forever. It's a reality. And every one of us has a time when we're going to no longer be on this earth in this physical body. We accept that fact, but we try to prepare. We try to prepare, but a lot of the things that we do to prepare really, really kind of focus on preserving our memory with those we leave behind, or to pass something along to them that we've acquired through our hard work so that they would be taken care of. A lot of our preparations have to do with those types of things. But the one way that we can be ready for ourselves is to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. John 3:16 is the best expression of that. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, his one and only son, that anybody that believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." He is the light. So the question is, do you know the Savior? Are you in the light? Are you ready? Is there real peace in your mind, in your heart? Is there? Because he is the Prince of Peace. And he's right here. He's right where you are. Wherever you're watching this, on your device or your computer, he is right there with you. This same person that Simeon was holding in his arms and singing this declaration and identification to is right here. And I hope you're not that person that says, No thanks. I think I'm fine. And you walk back out into the darkness. I just want to put it this way, and this is not a pressure tactic, but let's think of the logic here. Consider this, if you were to believe what the Bible says, and if you do believe what it says about life, about salvation, and you come to the end of your life and you've put it into practice and you have been blessed, you have benefited from all the truth and all the promises and all the good advice and the good counsel, and you've enjoyed all the good things that it offered, and you've been happy. But let's just say you find out that you go into an eternal sleep, and it's all this other stuff isn't real. What have you lost? Nothing. But you gained all the positive impact of the truth and how it impacted your life and how it brought you hope and peace. Okay, but think about the other side of it. This is what I just want to invite you to think about for a moment. If you were to reject it and say no, no thank you, and you spend your life saying no, you don't want to accept it. You don't want to believe it. You don't want that personal relationship with Jesus Christ because it just doesn't fit your paradigm of thinking or your ideology, your philosophy. Okay, it's true. God loves us enough to let us choose for ourselves, and I respect that. But what if you come to the end of your earthly existence only to find out that it was, in fact, true? Then what do you lose? Everything. And even worse is that the part of the reason God offers you salvation in the first place is because a refusal of Him means you choose the consequence of that. And that's not something we like to think about, but if He's offering you eternity to continue to exist in a place of rest and peace and love and hope, and a place where He resides, a place where there's no suffering, no sickness, no death, no nothing, no sadness, no separation, a place that He's prepared for each and every one of His children. If He's offering that for free, then the opposite to that is not what He wants, but it's a natural consequence. If I choose to say no to that, I am saying yes to the consequence of rejection of that, and that is to continue to exist eternally, but separated from Him. And that is the most horrible thing we could think of if we really allow ourselves to think about it. He does not want you to end up there, and He's done everything necessary and possible to offer you, because He's not going to force you either way. He loves you too much to say, you don't have a choice, you have to come to heaven. He says, if you want it, it's yours, but you have to receive it. A gift that I'm offering you is not yours until you apply it, till you take it. And that's what He wants. So what if it's true? What if Simeon was right? What if Jesus wasn't lying when He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Me. What if He was telling the truth? I'm here to say that with every fiber in my being, I am convinced that it is true. That it is true. He is the light. He loves you. And right now He wants to save you and bring you out of darkness into the light. That's why He died on the cross, so that you could receive forgiveness, cleansing, hope, and eternity with Him. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? It's this simple. I'm going to close with this, because somebody that's here or somebody that's watching online just might be sitting here going, yeah, for a long time I've been saying no thanks. And I realize that I've remained in dark places, and I want to give this light an opportunity in my life. And I want to surrender my heart to Jesus Christ. Then I invite you to just pray this prayer with me in your heart. Right now, you just repeat these same words. You're talking to Him. You're just talking to Him, and He's listening right now. So let's all bow our heads and close our eyes. If you're in the light, then pray with me for anyone who might be about to pray this prayer. Please. And if you think of somebody that you know needs this, name them in your prayer. But let's close in prayer now in this moment. And you pray these words. Lord Jesus, I believe in my heart that you are the light and the Savior. I believe in my heart that you died on the cross for my sins. And I thank you for becoming human so that you could do that for me and be an example for me. Thank you for loving me enough to do that for me. And I ask you to forgive me of all the thoughts and words and actions that have separated me from you, that have kept me in the dark. And I invite you to come in to every part of my life and change me and save my soul and give me that eternal life with you that you've promised and that you've come to give me. And I thank you for saving my soul. I want to walk with you from this day on, and I want to live in your light from this moment on. In Jesus' name, amen. I have never regretted that decision. I have never regretted that decision to come into the light. And if you prayed that prayer in your heart this morning, either here or online, then this is your family. This is your family now, Summit Church. Somebody needs to hear about this. So let us know. Let somebody you know from Summit Church. Let Pastor Drew know. Let me know. Because this is the beginning of something awesome in your life. And there's a lot more to learn and grow in. And we wouldn't want you to just drift out there. We want you to become a part of the family of Jesus Christ. So do let someone know. And I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to share Simeon's song with you. Kind of exciting, hey? So walk in the light. Walk in the light. Give it away this week to somebody. Share it with somebody. I just want to just say we love you, and we hope you have an awesome and blessed week. This is all for today, and just have a wonderful, wonderful week, and we'll see you next Sunday again here at Summit Church. We are dismissed. God bless you all.